Hi, I'm Georgina Collins, a freelance translator working with BAQWA in Cameroon and the University of Bristol in the UK. Today, I'm interviewing two contributors to a brand new bilingual Cameroonian anthology of short stories published by BAQWA and called Your Feet Will Lead You Where Your Heart Is and Le Crépuscule des âmes sœurs. So I'll be conducting the interview in both French and in English. And let's start with introductions. Shall we begin with you, Bill?
Okay. So my name is Bill. I'm a medical doctor working in Cameroon, in Boya precisely. I love to write. I read for fun and also for creative purposes. So that's me.
Thank you. And Marie-Hélène, c'est à toi?
Je m'appelle Marie-Hélène Goa Galet. J'ai 27 ans, je suis camerounaise, traductrice principale, après la cour d'appel du littoral. Bon, j'ai participé à l'atelier de traduction organisé par BAQWA en collaboration avec l'Université de Bristol, où j'ai beaucoup appris sur la traduction littéraire.
So Bill, perhaps you can start by telling us a little bit about your short story.
So the short story is in a relatively new context. So when BAQWA sent out the invites asking for stories and they wanted something about the Cameroonian context, I thought to myself, what is really making headlines now? And it's the story of prophets. So in Cameroon, the country is kind of a religious country. Many people believe in some system of religion. So Christianity, Muslims, and so on. But in the Christian sphere now, there's a lot of, everybody's a prophet. It's being a pastor is a good business, you see. So starting a church, having people come to church and miracles and all of that. So many Christians are following that and looking for that. And then also I was asking myself now, but we've never had the context of a man of God who is able to raise the dead. So let's try to see exactly if it's possible to have a prophet try that kind of miracle. So that was what I was going for with the story. So I'm writing the story in a remote village where, because also before I continue about the story, also some of the setting, the context is our country here, it's like in all countries, is divided into castes, into hierarchy. So they are the rich, the poor, and the middle class. And the rich exert relatively more influence. They have a lot more clout, so they can do a lot more. So I was asking myself if I need the story is talking about a rich man who dies in a relatively remote and urban, remote semi-urban village, yes. And so because his wife and his family can afford and they believe so much in prophets and pastors, they ask a pastor to come around and to raise this man to life. But this pastor is kind of a charlatan, because that's what I was going for, but I try not to disclose that as much in the story. So rather than make the whole ceremony about the raising of the dead, he's going to try to throw some different light, turn it instead in a different direction, move it towards finding who exactly killed the man and try to find the whole solution without actually doing the miracle. So that's kind of the backdrop of the story. That's what I was going for in my head.
Can you tell us a little bit about the form and style of your short story?
So the story is written in the first person, the first voice. So because I wanted the accused, in quotes, the guilty parts, to want to experience the story, because it made more sense for me that, given that he's the one who is going to be in the end point index, let's leave the event through him. So it's written in the active voice, first of all, and the first person who is writing. So and then also about that, I used a lot of assonance in the story, because, and also a little more of sarcasm, because some of the things that are happening are not exactly, in a normal society, are ridiculous even to think about, but because some of those things are normalized here, yes, there's a lot of sarcasm in the story also. So
Well, I have to say for the record, I really did enjoy it. And I can see that there was a lot for a translator to get their teeth into. So over to Marie-Hélène again now. Comment as-tu abordé la traduction?
Normalement, quand je prends un texte pareil, je prends le temps de lire au moins 3 fois pour comprendre, pour être dans la logique de l'auteur. Alors, la première fois que j'ai lu le texte, j'ai éclaté de rire parce que c'est un texte qui m'a beaucoup fait rire. Du coup, j'avais hâte de traduire. Maintenant, quand j'ai lu le texte, je me suis rendu compte que le niveau de langue était un peu au début élevé, puis après, bon, le niveau de langue changeait graduellement chaque fois que je lisais le texte. Donc, en étant camerounaise, moi aussi, j'ai compris le texte et déjà, je suis restée fidèle au texte. Je n'ai pas voulu changer. C'est vrai qu'au début, j'ai voulu améliorer dans la traduction, mais mon mentor a joué son rôle et m'a recadrée. Donc, je suis restée fidèle au texte, à la culture de l'auteur et voilà, c'est tout. Je n'ai rien ajouté, rien enlevé.
Est-ce qu'il y avait un problème spécifique qui était difficile à surmonter peut-être?
Déjà, je remarque que Bill et moi ne sommes pas de la même ethnie. Nous n'avons pas la même culture. Donc, le texte était beaucoup plus culturel à un cerveau. Il y avait des mots difficiles à comprendre. J'étais obligée de m'adresser à mes collègues traducteurs de la même ethnie parce que Bill, bon, c'est un médecin et au Cameroun, les médecins sont très, très occupés. Donc, les mots comme mbé, je ne sais pas, je n'avais pas compris en fait. Donc, j'étais obligée de demander à Z. James. Donc, c'est Z James qui m'a aidé à comprendre le mot. Les mots comme shooting case, box, je crois, c'était très, très difficile à rendre. Donc, j'ai juste adapté le mot à, je crois, sachet plastique. Parce que c'est ce que les femmes font ici. Dans les réunions, par exemple, elles s'en vont avec des plastiques. Des sachets plastiques pour emballer les nourritures. Donc, c'est dans la logique, là, bon, j'ai compris ça dans le sens, là. Mais vraiment, les mots culturels ont été vraiment, vraiment, vraiment difficiles à rendre, puisque nous ne sommes pas, on partage pas la même culture. Mm. Voilà.
It's interesting that, isn't it? Because during the workshops, we spoke so much about the importance of, you know, somebody in Cameroon translating another Cameroonian writer's work. But then you're saying that even within Cameroon itself, there are so many cultural and linguistic differences that have to be overcome. Phil, back over to you then. How did you feel about having your work translated? Did you have any expectations as a writer?
Well, obviously I did have expectations. It was the first time I was getting my work translated and I was like, oof, let's see how it sounds in French. Because I'd read a lot of French stories, short stories especially, written by some people, very remarkable writers. And it always intrigued me the way the French language, the drama around the French language, you get the story, it's more real. There's a thrill that it gives you reading a story written in French, in our context especially. So I was really excited to see if my story in French would give that same thrill.
So did you enjoy reading the translation?
Well, I did. I had a field time. I was really laughing for most of it because Marie-Hélène, she, like she said, I think there was some cultural and the cultural context was different. So there were some words that I saw. She really puts a lot of effort into trying to get the exact meaning. So it gave a funny touch in French, which was really hilarious. So I enjoyed reading the translation, and I think she did a very good job with it.
I think that the fact that you laughed when you read the translation, and she laughed when she read the story, and the whole idea of the having the same effect on the reader, both the text and the translation, is quite an achievement, really, Marie-Hélène.
Thank you.
Es-tu contente avec la traduction?
Oh, je suis tellement satisfaite. parce que les débuts, vraiment, comme on dit, tous les débuts sont difficiles. Parce que moi, j'étais seule. J'étais seule à traduire cette histoire. Donc, je me disais, peut-être je ne vais pas y arriver. Donc, j'étais un peu stressée. Et c'était beaucoup culturel. Donc, au début, j'étais un peu frustrée. Je me disais, non, j'ai traduit. Bon, pour cette histoire, j'ai au moins 3 versions hein, de traduction. Parce que au début, je n'étais pas très sûre, très, très sûre. Mais à la fin, j'étais plutôt relax. J'étais contente. Quand j'ai relu mon histoire dans le livre, j'étais tellement contente. Très satisfaite de mon travail.
Alors, il n'y a pas des petites choses que tu veux changer maintenant? Après un peu de temps?
Ça m'arrive très, très souvent, chaque fois que je relis, parce que bon, c'est ma fierté, donc je n'arrête pas de lire et relire, je n'en reviens pas d'avoir produit un travail aussi bien fait. Mais il y a certaines phrases que j'ai tendance à vouloir améliorer. Donc, mais après, j'hésite, je dis non, j'ai très peur de mal faire. Donc. Mais il y en a toujours, il y a des phrases que j'ai envie d'améliorer, peut-être dans le style, oui, peut-être j'ai envie de retourner une phrase, oui, ça m'arrive très souvent.
Mais c'est normal, that's the job of the translator, and I think we're never 100% satisfied. You can keep going and going and going, I think. Was there anything, Bill, that particularly impressed you about the translation?
Well, the particular scene, there was one scene in the story about the women who were cooking food at the back and the shooting case wrappings I was talking about. So I'll just, before I go, I'll try to explain to Marie exactly what the shooting case wrappings mean so that it helps her. So in our context, like she said already, when people attend occasions, most times they come with a small wrapping. They call it shooting case. So shooting case, there's excess food, they're going to carry some back in the wrappings. So they're like takeaways. But in a context, we don't have to use shooting case. So yeah, I was really impressed with the way she translated that particular scene that stood out for me in the whole text, because I did not think somebody was going to get it as accurately as she did in French.
So that's a wonderful compliment. Yeah, that's a wonderful compliment, Marie-Hélène, I think, that coming from
Thank you.
It's what you want to hear. So perhaps we could finish up by talking a little bit about the workshops that you both did. So Bill, you did the creative writing workshop with Bakwa in Bristol, and Marie-Hélène, the translation workshop after that with Bakwa in Bristol. So Bill, maybe you could tell us, you know, how did that influence your work?
Okay, so first of all, this was the creative writing workshop with Bakwa was the first one I was attending since I started writing. I'd been writing stories for a little under 2 years, but it was really just for me. I had only one published story that won a local competition, a national competition here. And then I was writing for a magazine, Writer Space Africa. So having a workshop, attending Bakwa's workshop was really like an eye-opener for me on so many things, on voice, on setting a team, on character development, and all of that. So I was really, really, I learned a lot from the workshop because I'd never been to one of them. And finally, having to be there with Billy Kaora and having him make us write, we had so many writing exercises. All of that opened my mind to how to better ameliorate my character development, my setting, my voice as a person. And since he always gave us regular feedback, it also really, because after that they had the mentorship, but where during the writing we were mentored by Billy Kaora. My mentor was Billy Kaora, and he really gave me feedback and told me, no, your voice here is weak, your voice here is strong. And one particular thing that I learned was, I had the tendency of, especially the conclusions for my story, I felt that the story had to have, for it to be good enough, had to have a particular ending. So it could not just leave you hanging. It had to, all the questions had to be answered in my head. And so when I wrote the first draft, I think that was the major problem with the first draft. Billy was like, oh, your story just seems so predictable. All the questions are answered. Why don't you give us a little bit of something to want to read over, a little bit of angst? That was the word he called it. So that the whole creative writing workshop was really an eye-opener for me on so many levels. And I think it's what has really pushed me to want to do a master's in creative writing.
Well, I wanted at this stage to ask Marie-Hélène a little bit more about her experience, and hopefully she'll come back in 1 second. But perhaps in the meantime, it'd be nice to hear a little bit about what you're doing now in terms of your writing, if you've had much of a chance as a doctor to continue your efforts. And Marie-Hélène will come back to you in a second.
Well, it's not exactly easy juggling writing, because writing is like a full career on its own. I was talking to a friend of mine who also happens to be in Bakwa, and he was like, oh, he had to abandon school and his PhD program for writing. So it's really a whole career on its own. And also being a doctor is a full-time commitment. If something happens to somebody under your watch, you have to explain and all of that. So it makes it a bit heavy for me writing. So now I get flashes of scenes, because one thing I left Bakwa with the creative writing workshop was to see the world differently. So maybe something could happen on the road and then I'll be like, this is a good scene. So I have all those incomplete drafts that I just type from time to time and keep. So I'm working on stories, many stories, but they're not exactly progressing really fast because of work and all. It's not very easy to juggle it.
No, it isn't with a full-time job like that, I imagine. But then there's no rush. There's no rush. You can take your time and we'll all enjoy reading some more of your work when it does come out. So Marie-Hélène, we were talking a little bit about the workshops. Qu'est-ce que tu as appris pendant les ateliers? Tu as travaillé bien sûr avec Edwige Droz et un petit peu aussi avec moi et Rochefortz.
Oui, oui. Déjà, je remercie Bakwa parce que, bon, c'était tellement, tellement édifiant. Donc, déjà, quand je venais, je ne savais pas à quoi m'attendre. J'avais une autre vision de la traduction littéraire qui était totalement contraire à ce que j'ai eu à apprendre là-bas. Déjà, je remarque, bon, je garde en tête 3 points que Edwige n'arrêtait pas de nous rappeler tout le temps. Donc, la fidélité dans le texte, il faut rester fidèle à la traduction, fidèle au texte source, ne rien ajouter, ne rien enlever et transporter avec toi l'émotion et tout ce qui va avec, tenir compte même du niveau de langue. La musicalité, donc donner un rythme à ta phrase, il faudrait que ta phrase, que ça coule, c'est ce que Edwige Droz n'arrêtait pas de nous dire. Il faut une musicalité, il faut donner. Donc, je pense que j'ai tenu compte de ça et je ne suis pas prête à oublier tout ça, en fait. Donc, au final, l'atelier a été vraiment, vraiment très édifiant.
Et pour toi, maintenant, qu'est-ce qu'il y a? Qu'est-ce que l'étape suivante en tant que traductrice littéraire?
Bon, continuer de traduire des textes. Et sauter sur toutes les occasions qui me seront données d'assister aux ateliers de traduction à nouveau, parce que je ne peux pas dire que je suis complète. Il faudrait toujours que je sois tout le temps, que je me frotte quoi, à la traduction littéraire pour être sûre que je suis déjà prête. Et cela m'a ouvert, m'a donné une autre idée, celle d'écrire, peut-être, pourquoi pas. Comme je disais au début, j'ai bien envie d'écrire des nouvelles aussi, mais beaucoup plus sur l'autonomisation de la femme, voilà.
Good luck with your endeavors. And I don't think we actually mentioned the title of your story within this book, which is Death Never Comes with Silence and La Folle Journée. So thank you very much, both of you, for taking time out of your busy schedule. And again, good luck with your work going forward.
Thank you.